So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. Recently, somebody had asked me a question that what is the proper etiquette? How should we actually invite spiritual personalities and sadhus and our gurus, especially to our homes? And I see that many people are not aware of this. Of course, this is not a topic to make a video on, because this has been traditionally taught by God's grace in the Vedic tradition, especially in countries like India and also in many other countries. But unfortunately, because of the influence of Kali Yuga, these things are being forgotten, and I see people doing so many blunders when it comes to this topic. Because it's very important that we do it the right way, okay? Because spiritual personalities, they are considered to be like a razor sharp sword. What can you do with a sword? You can, if you give it to a criminal, the criminal will go and murder somebody. Okay. But if you have the sword or a knife, which is very sharp, if you give it to a nice person, then they may do great things. You can cut vegetables, you can do surgery, you can fix things, so many other things you can do. All right. So therefore, sadhus or great personalities, spiritually elevated personalities, they are also like that. So if we treat them properly and we take enlightenment from them, then we will make rapid spiritual progress. Yes, Rishabhdev in the Srimad Bhagavatam says to his to all of his 100 sons, and especially to the most esteemed of his sons, Bharat Maharaj, he says, Tapo Divyam Putra Kayena Sattvam. It's a very, very, very famous shloka from the 5th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So if you have not read it, then please go and read it now. And then that shloka means that, my dear sons, you must do tapasya. Tapo Divyam Putra Kayena Sattvam. Only after that you will be eligible to sit in the throne. Okay, just because you are born from my semen, this does not qualify you to sit in the throne. Okay, and that is the same Bharat after which the entire holy land of India is known. Yes, India is known after this personality, Bharat Maharaj. Of course, there are many Bharats. One Bharat is the younger brother of Lord Ramachandra himself, and the other Bharat is the king who is the ancestor of Bhishma and Arjuna. That is why that Vansh, that dynasty is known as Bharat Vansh. Okay, and that is why we have Mahabharat. It's the story of the great dynasty of Bharat. That is the one of the meanings of the word Mahabharat. And it has many meanings, of course. So, and then Rishabhdev goes to say that, he says in the Srimad Bhagavatam that the service to the great souls open the doors to liberation. All right. So most of the times people, they are asking, or spiritual seekers are always very eager to know how to open the doors of moksha, liberation, spiritual perfection. Yes. Mahat sevanam api dwara vimukteshu. So that very, 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 very famous statement is there. That shloka is there from Srimad Bhagavatam. All right. Mahat sevanam means when we serve the great personalities, api dwara vimukteshu, which means the doors to liberation open, all right? And if you know the full shloka, you can quote it down below. Let me see. I don't remember the shloka exactly. Maybe there is some error in what I have said, but this is what I remember. Okay, so please write it down in the comments if you know the right shloka or the full shloka. Okay, I would love to see it. So therefore, it is very essential that we do it the right way. Now, when I say right way, I don't mean that we do it the wrong way, but we should do it properly, okay? Which means we should be doing certain things which we are not doing, okay? And we should not do certain things which we are doing, okay? All right, so therefore, today we shall discuss these things in short. And as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your horoscope, then you can always go to my website. You will find the link down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him. Even if you don't find Him, you can find the sadhus especially. All right. So So this will hold true generally for any spiritual personality. Not necessarily they should be our gurus or our Diksha Guru or our Shiksha Gurus or our Pat Pradastya Gurus. This can refer to any other spiritual personality also. This can refer to somebody who is not connected to our parampara, to a different lineage, a different parampara also. Okay. Or in general for any, as I said, for anybody in fact. Okay. So within the different schools of thought, like, you know, Mimamsa and other, so irrespective of what it is, we should always apply these principles. Okay. So we have to understand the position of the guru, okay, or gurus or whatever you want to call them, you know, one or plural. So the guru's position is very, very, very special. Okay, the guru's position, there's a very famous shloka quoted by, said by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. He says, you know, Saksha dharitvena samasta shastir uktasta thava vitaiva sadhvi kintu prabhorya priyaiva tatsya vande guru shri charanarvindam. All right, so this shloka means that the spiritual master is to be considered as good as God. He should be treated as good as God. Not that he is treated as God, as good as God. Okay, so this means the amount of respect you would give, if just imagine, you know, if Lord Vishnu would appear in front of you, you know, if you would say that, okay, tomorrow I will be coming to your home, what would you do? So that same level of respect we should give to the guru also, not because that he is God or he is like incarnation of God or something like that. Not because of that. The tattva is different, of course, but he is the representative of God. Okay, because he is the one through whom God's mercy manifests in our life. All right, without his grace, there is no future in spiritual life. Okay, because God is beyond all our material senses. You know, we can see Krishna's photo sometimes. We may think, oh, maybe Krishna looks like this, and maybe he smiles, maybe he, you know, he's giggling, or he's, you know, eating butter, or maybe Lord Ram is touching Dashrath Maharaj's feet. We can imagine all those things. That's very good. We are using our intelligence. That's very good. But the true spiritual connection which we have with God is only established once we are connected to the guru through the system of parampara. Okay, if we are not connected, then it is very difficult to make spiritual progress. Okay, so therefore, if we are lucky enough to have found a guru or a parampara or a spiritual community, you know, then we must make sure that we should treat them properly. Okay. And especially for those who are married, for grihasthas, okay, it is very, very, very important that you very frequently invite sadhus to your home. Because grihastha means, there are two kinds of householders actually. One is grihamedi, the other one is grihastha. So grihamedi means one who is married but is not having any God-centric life, okay. Or they may have also, like many people, they have, you know, some small mandir in their home, or, you know, they just do some agarbatti in the morning. And then in the night, they just forget everything. All right. So, or maybe they don't have anything. They're just not doing anything at all in the any spiritual practice itself. Okay. So, or they may be doing in the day, but in the night, they do so much nonsense that it doesn't matter. It throws out everything which they have done in the morning. Have you seen people? In the morning, they will be very spiritual. But as the night comes, you know, they are, as my guru used to say, na, Virat Swarup Bahar Aa Jata Hai. their inner self comes out. Their true self comes out in the night. Okay. So that is Griha Medhi. Okay. And Grihastha means one who stays in the home but has a spiritual foundation upon which the principles of married life are based. Okay, so for grihasthas, it is very important. So either we are a grihastha or we are a grihamedi, it is very, very, very important that we invite sadhus to our homes. Okay, because either you are a grihastha or a grihamedi, the married couples, their environment is heavily polluted because we have our job, you know, we either have our office, we have to go to the job or business, you know, and then we meet all these materialistic people 24/7. And then sometimes there are TV movies and all these things also go on in most of the house of the householders. So therefore, it is highly, highly, highly essential that we invite sadhus, because only then we can experience purification inside. Okay, otherwise our spiritual progress is simply an illusion. Actually, it's like the illusion of materialistic pleasure. We think we are happy, but that the spiritual life can also be illusion sometimes. Okay, and for many people it is like that. I have seen, which means they think that they are advancing, but they're not making any progress. It's zero. Why? Because they are not in contact with spiritual personalities. Okay, it is not important to do big things in spiritual life. Okay, it is the most important thing in spiritual life is we stay connected to the sadhus. Okay, otherwise, and sadhu, when I say sadhu, I'm very clear with the word. I don't mean that that person has to be a sannyasi or has to be in saffron. Okay, sadhus can also be married. So when I say sadhu, you don't have to imagine, oh, he's not wearing any clothes, or, you know, he's just wearing one cloth, or he has a danda or a sannyasi, or not like that. Anybody who has given you spiritual knowledge, okay, that person is also like your guru. Okay, that person is like your shiksha guru. And then diksha guru is the one who gives you initiation, all right? So diksha basically, right? So therefore, the sadhu word doesn't mean that that person only has to be wearing saffron or, you know, white or anything like that. That person can be just a normal person. You know, he could be a YouTuber or IT engineer or anybody, all right? But he or she is very elevated in spiritual consciousness, all right? So either ways you have to deal with them like this, all right? So then the first thing is we have to understand what is the purpose of inviting the sadhu to the home. Okay, the purpose of inviting is not to get some ashirvad from them. All right, so from here I will be speaking a lot of heavy stuff. All right, so if you are not very used to the stuff which I speak in some of my videos, then you may not like this. All right, so you may close this video now, it's up to you. But if you really want to invite sadhus properly, then you must watch this. So most of the times people think that the only business of a sadhu is that he will come and give some ashirvad like this. And have you seen ashirvad gurus like this? You know, sab shubh ho, sab mangal ho, sir, mera beta foreign ja raha hai, sab shubh ho, sab mangal ho, sir, meri beti beti foreign ja rahi hai, beti ki shadi ho rahi hai, mera bete ka beta ho raha hai, bete ka beti ho raha hai, beti ka आशीर्वाद दीजिए गुरुजी, आशीर्वाद दीजिए, सब शुभ हो, सब शुभ हो, ना शुभ हो, शुभ शुभ शुभ. अरे क्या नॉनसेंस है, क्या शुभ है, दिस इज अ वेरी स्टूपिड बिजनेस, जस्ट गोइंग ऑन ब्लेसिंग पीपल अराउंड लाइक दैट. दैट्स नॉट व्हाट इज द जॉब ऑफ अ साधु. द साधुस प्राइमरी जॉब, हिज प्राइमरी ड्यूटी इज टू एनलाइटन पीपल अबाउट स्पिरिचुअलिटी, अबाउट गॉड एंड द प्रोसेस ऑफ स्पिरिचुअलिटी, द नॉलेज ऑफ द श्रीमद भागवतम एंड द भगवद गीता. Primarily, that is the prime goal of the sadhu. If the sadhu is not doing that and going on giving blessings, he's just cheating you, he's just wasting your time. Okay, throw them out of your homes if they are doing like this. So therefore, we should understand the purpose of inviting them. The purpose of inviting them is not to, okay, Guruji, ashirvad dijiye, sab theek ho, sab acha ho, shubh ho, shubh ho. Nothing is there in the hands. All right, so. So the first thing is we should understand that they must enlighten us spiritually. Okay, and that brings me to the first point, which means, okay, when you invite them, there are many different traditions in India. You know, some people touch their feet, some people wash their feet, and you can do that as per as your tradition. My focus is not that. That is important, of course. And then when you give a elevated seat to the sun, okay, then I remember. It was the year 2012, I guess, those golden days. 2012, I was in Pune, India. Pune is a city in Maharashtra, India, you know, in western part of India. And there, inside Pune, there is a place called Hadapsar. Okay, So I was in Hadapsar in Pune. So maybe those who are in Pune, you will now write. Okay, so then I was there, and one of my gurus had come there. And there was a family who had invited him, and that guru told me, "You can also come with me. You can be like my assistant." So I was very happy, of course. And then he told me that, "Okay, you can take this mic stand, and now you can carry this Gita." And then I was just obeying him. And then finally, we reached that person's home. Okay, so as I said, the primary duty of the guru is to remind you of God. That is the prime most duty. All right, no compromise in that. Everything else later. Then what happened was, it was very funny. This family was very affluent, very rich, and they invited this guru. Okay, and there was this head of the family. Okay, the man. And then there were so many ladies, you know, they came and touched his feet, and this man called his children. They came and touched his feet, and you know, all those formalities were over. And I was very happy, and I was very enthusiastic, and I was very eager. But all my expectations were shattered completely. So what happened? They told Guruji, "Bait here, yahan pe, go and sit. Please sit here." You know? And then what? It was so surprising that this person who was the owner of this house, the family, who was the main person, he was somewhere in his 50s, okay, and he had grandchildren also, 50s or 60s around. So he started talking about himself. All right, he started telling, "गुरुजी हमने तो अपने जिंदगी में ये किया है, हमने वो किया है, 20 साल पहले हमने ये किया, 20 years back I did this. Actually, you know, गुरुजी 30 years back my grandfather was there. You know, my grandfather had gone to Haridwar, and then my father went here. He did this, he did that. My wife did this, my wife did that. I did this, I did that." Half an hour he wasted just speaking about himself and what his wife did, what his father did, and what his family did. That is all he did. Just simply wasted half an hour, or maybe even more than that. Okay. And then my Guruji was just sitting there. I mean, of course, that is also an etiquette that you should not interrupt anybody when they are speaking. And then this person asked the Guruji. He told, "Guruji, bataiye, aap apne baare mein bataiye. Tell me about yourself." Okay. So the guru doesn't come to speak about himself. Okay. He comes to speak about God. Okay. He can speak about himself around 5 to 10 or 10-20%, but that's not the primary objective. That's not the agenda. That can be done when you are eating food, you are eating prasad with him. Then that can be done. But the primary goal is you should be enlightened about God and the scriptures. That is the primary goal. There's no compromise with that. Okay. And then the guru said, "Actually, मैं अपने बारे में तो ज्यादा नहीं बोलूंगा, मैं भगवत गीता के बारे में ज्यादा बोलूंगा. आई विल नॉट स्पीक अबाउट माई सेल्फ, आई विल स्पीक अबाउट द भगवत गीता हियर." एंड देन दिस पर्सन टोल्ड हिम, नहीं, गुरु जी उसकी क्या जरूरत है, व्हाट इज द नीड, वो तो हम ऐसे भी जानते हैं, दैट वी ऑलरेडी नो. वी नो गीता, वी नो रामायण, वी नो महाभारत, वी नो एवरीथिंग, वी नो एवरीथिंग. एक्चुअली वी नो नथिंग, बट स्टिल वी नो एवरीथिंग, राइट? एंड देन ही सेड, "टेल मी अबाउट योर सेल्फ, आप जवानी में क्या करते थे, व्हेन यू वर यंग व्हाट यू डिड, एंड यू नो इट्स लाइक." एंड देन माय गुरुजी, ही वाज लाइक, यू नो, डिलेमा व्हाट टू डू. एंड देन ही सेड, "या एक्चुअली, या यू नो, 30 years बैक व्हेन आई वाज इन दिस प्लेस, आई हैड डन दिस, एंड आई डिड माय ग्रेजुएशन देयर, आई डिड माय, देन आई वाज वर्किंग, यू नो." एंड देन इमीडिएटली दिस पर्सन अगेन, मैन, ही अगेन स्टार्टेड, "अरे गुरुजी वो जगह मैं जानता हूँ, आई नो. एक्चुअली ना 25 साल पहले, 25 years बैक, यू नो, आई डिड दिस देयर. आई हैव सम कॉन्ट्रैक्ट डीलर्स देयर, यू नो, आई हैव माय बिजनेस, दिस इज गोइंग ऑन, दैट इज गोइंग ऑन." एंड देन माय गुरुजी सेड दैट, "ओके, देन लेटर ऑन, यू नो, आई डिड दिस हियर. आई वेंट टू आंध्र प्रदेश, आई वेंट टू, यू नो, केरला, देन आई वेंट टू वेस्ट बंगाल, आई डिड दिस." And any place this guru mentions, this person is like boasting how many contacts he has and how great he is, how powerful he is, how invincible he is. You know, not seeing the inevitable death which is coming. Death is very near. His age is, that's like 8 years back. That time he was in his 60s. Now I don't know how much will be his age, 50s or 60s. So now he's definitely at the end of his 60s. So therefore, the first golden rule is that when the guru comes, we should shut our mouths. Yes, just pin drop silence. Let the guru talk. If you want to talk, then we can invite some of our friends and we can keep boasting to them, you know, what we did 20 years back, what we did 15 years back, what we did yesterday night, what we did 10 days back, you know, how great we are, how powerful we are, how influential we are, right? How we can get things done so fast, you know. Or sometimes people do the other way around also, how terrible their lives are, how miserable they are, how failure, how many times they have failed, you know. So if you want to do this only, then we don't have to invite sadhus. We can just invite some of our friends or colleagues or family members, relatives. We can keep crying or we can boasting. We can keep boasting. And then you cry, they will also cry. You boast, they will also boast. That's how materialistic society works. Okay. Everybody is trying to prove that they are more miserable than others or they are more powerful than somebody else. Okay. So that is not the way how you deal with sadhus, because if you are wasting their time like this, okay, by boasting about the greatness of you, your husband, your wife, your family, your children, your mother, father, whoever they are, doesn't matter. Now the point is they have come here, so you must listen to what they have to say, okay. And if you do this, if you waste their time like this, because their time is very precious, so if you waste their time like this, then God will take note of it. Okay. And then when you need spiritual wisdom or guidance, they won't come because you didn't allow them to speak. So why should they come? They will not come the next time. Okay. So therefore, it is very crucial that we do not waste their time like this and we give them an opportunity to speak and enlighten us by telling what they have heard from their gurus. Okay. Because the guru is not a whimsical, independent person who just keeps speaking things out of his own concoction. Sometimes I see people saying, you know, oh, according to me, I think, yes, no, nothing like that. Nothing about your opinion or my opinion. The opinion is very clear. Whatever the scriptures say, that is the opinion. That is God's opinion. And we just present it as it is through the parampara. Okay. We do not concoct or speculate scriptural truths, because the Srimad Bhagavatam says very clearly, dharmam tu sakchat bhagavat pranitam. Dharma is defined directly by God himself. Alright. So therefore, we cannot decide what is good, bad, what is right, wrong, because if you go and talk to people, they will say, oh, mere mutabik ye achha hai. In my opinion, this is good. Mere mutabik wo achha nahi hai. And other ones will say, nahi, nahi, wo theek hai. This is good, this is bad. So no nonsense here. No opinion games. Okay. No speculation here. Is directly what is there in the scriptures and what your guru has told you, that you just tell. It's very clear. No ambiguity there. Okay. And then when you are done, the guru has spoken for half an hour or 1 hour or 2 hour or 3 hours. The longer the better, of course. Then we should be, if we have certain questions, we can ask them. All right. But the questions should be in a mood of humility. Okay. So recently, one person asked me a question that I told in some video, that one should never argue with the guru, you know, but if you don't ask questions, how will you progress in spiritual life? Well, there's a big difference between asking a question and arguing with somebody. Okay. You can ask 1,000 questions to your gurus. I have asked so many questions literally when I was in Chennai. It was like sometimes till 3 a.m. in the morning, not 3, I would say around 1 or 1:30 sometimes, or maybe 2 also. Till 2 a.m. in the morning, from 6 p.m. to 2 a.m., how much it is? 8 hours. Is it 8? Yes. 8 hours I used to discuss about the Gita and about so many other things from the scriptures. No? So nobody ever told me that. I have never found any genuine guru till now in my life. What I've never seen anywhere else also, or anybody telling me that when you're asking questions, you know, they are saying you are arrogant. No, that never happens. And if the guru is saying that, then he actually doesn't know what to answer. That is why he's, you know, trying to tell you that, you know, you are arrogant. But that does not mean that we try to test the guru. Oh, dekhte hai isko aata hai ki nahi. Oh, actually, you know, I read this there, I read it here. You know, there are people who do like this. In Kali Yuga, there are so many people. I know they will, they're going on testing their gurus. Okay. Now, testing does not mean in a negative sense. It is your right to test the guru, which means you should know what the guru, you should know if the guru is a proper guru or not. Otherwise, then that is another problem. But what I am saying here is, there are people who will, you know, intentionally, they will ask some really, really, really stupid questions, which has no base actually, all right? And the guru also knows you are playing tricks. So you think you are smart, but the problem is, or the good thing is, he's more smarter than you. Okay. So he will give you such answers by which you will be trapped in your own questions. Okay. So therefore, we should ask questions with humility. Okay. And then we offer him something to eat, of course. And now this is very important. Yes, we know that when we invite somebody, we like to, you know, make the best dishes, you know, the best of the cuisines. You know, we like to make a 20-course meal or, you know, 100-course feast. I know that it's very good. But the problem is, the guru may be very spiritual, but he is still in the material body. Okay. So this means that if you make 20 dishes out of your love, which is very true, the guru may not be able to eat each one of them. Okay. So therefore, my guru used to say, you know, 5. That's all. Roti, sabji, dal, water, and 1 dessert if you wish. Otherwise, 4 is good enough. Or instead of the dessert, you make 2 sabjis. Okay. Enough for the day. See, because the guru is in a material body. So he has to abide by that that limitation. He or she cannot go on eating whatever you give. Okay. And the second problem is these people generally, they have back-to-back house programs. Okay. So imagine if you have 3 house programs a day and 3 times you are eating, you know, a 20-course meal. It might seem so tempting initially, right? When I'm telling it to you now, you are thinking, oh my God, I wish I could go to every home and keep eating, you know, 20 meals, you know, every meal I will taste this, this, this. But trust me, that's the worst thing that can happen to you in the long run, okay? Your health will be ruined, your spiritual progress will be ruined, you will lose your reputation, everything will be spoiled, because one whose tongue is not controlled, his belly is not controlled, and his genitals will also not be under control, okay? So therefore, we should not do things which is actually not possible. And sometimes I see, like when I was there in Hadapsar, I saw that person's elder sister was there, and she made some, you know, 15 different types of sweets alone. And she said that, Guruji, aapko har ek ka ek ek thoda thoda test karna padega. You have to taste each one of them a bit. And then it was like a very difficult situation. And then if you say out of so much love and affection you have made, then the guru also feels obliged. He also doesn't feel that very good to say no, actually. Okay. So do not put him in a precarious situation, because he might not be able to say no, because then you will feel bad. Okay. So therefore, we should make reasonable preparations. Of course, they can be good preparations. You can make in ghee instead of using oil. You can, you know, make nice dishes. Preferably, the cooking has to be done without onion garlic, because if he's a serious sadhu, elevated one, he would definitely not be taking onion and garlic. So, and then he would also only take prasad, which means you have to offer it also to God. Okay. So those things are fine, that we know. But the thing is, and many times we see, you know, they will force the guru to, you know, eat more and more. Now I understand it, that you are very much affectionate, you want to serve him very nicely, but understand that he has his limitations. He cannot eat like 20 people. Okay. He can just eat like 1 or 1.5 maybe. And therefore, and we should not cook things which are very much in rajas, you know, like sometimes I see people will cook, you know, some sabji, there's, you know, like tons of red chili powder, you know, they're like, they take this much red chili powder and just throw it. No, the food should be sattvic, okay, which means there should not be too much rajas or, you know, too much fried things, you know, these things are not very good actually, or too much sweet, you know, these things are very rajasic actually, they agitate the mind and the senses. We should be very careful not to eat those, and if we are eating, please do not offer those things, okay. Even if you want to make a dessert, make it light with not so much sugar or jaggery, then that is perfectly fine, okay. And if you are making some dish like pulao, it doesn't mean you will put, you know, like tons of ghee there. So that is not recommended, all right, because that will damage the person's body. And of course, apart from that, if you have to offer him any dakshina, any donations, you must offer, you need to offer, because that is the duty of grihastha to offer donations, okay. That is a very, very, very important duty. In fact, my guru used to say 10% of our income should be donated for a spiritual cause, okay. But anyways, I will make a video on that later. But and after that, we should take their blessings, okay. Blessings not because our son or daughter is going abroad, or, you know, they are getting married, okay. That's not the reason to get blessings. You can take those blessings also, but the main blessing which you should take from them is that let me elevate spiritually, all right. That blessing we should ask, and we should also request them that please come again, okay. So if they feel that they are being treated properly, then they will definitely come back again, okay. And if they feel that you are going on boasting about the glories of your great grandfather or grandmother or your grandson or your husband or your wife, then maybe you might not see their face again, okay. And I have seen that happening, all right. And after that, if it is night, you should also go and drop them to their place, of course, all right. Or you should send your car and invite them from their home while they are coming also. So these are the things which people do generally, and I have been seeing there's a lot of discrepancy when it comes to this. And many people have told me also to make a video on this, and some people are not aware in the West, okay. They've never done this, and sometimes they want to do, and then they are not aware what to do, okay. So the superficial things are not very important, like touching his feet or, you know, giving him lots of gifts or donations. Then that is fine. That is not the main. That's not very important. That is also important, but the most important is that the guru should enlighten you about spiritual knowledge, okay. And as a guru, it is his duty or her duty also to enlighten. And if the guru is only going on speaking some nonsense, you know, what happened in cricket, football, you know, which cricketer got married to which film actress, you know, these are the these kind of useless, stupid things the guru is discussing, then never ever ever invite that person to your home, okay, because he's just adding onto the garbage that you might already have in your house or in your consciousness, okay. So we do not want those kind of gurus, or we do not want the sweet speaking gurus. You know, sweet speaking means they will only tell what you want to hear, that's all, okay. So suppose your son or your daughter is going abroad, or, you know, is getting married, and then you say, oh, bete ka shadi nahi ho raha hai, beti ki shadi nahi ho rahi, okay. No, they are not getting married. Aashirwad dijiye, and they say, ho jayega, hum aashirwad dete, sab achha ho, sab shubh ho. If the guru is only doing that, not just saying yes, 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 yes to whatever you want, all right, then there's something. As in Hindi, they say, no, dal mein kuch kala hai. All right, so there's a serious problem there, okay. So he should be enlightening you and hammering you with spiritual truths, and only then you will have purification. Otherwise, he will just come and you both will have a good time, a great time, nice food, and then he leaves. All right, so that is how we should actually treat sadhus and great personalities and spiritually elevated beings when they come home. And I hope this helps you in understanding how you should treat them the next time. Okay. And if you have done any of these mistakes in the past, then no problem. You can call them and beg forgiveness and correct those mistakes. Okay. So if you have been boasting always about the greatness of your forefathers, okay, in front of the guru, then now you invite them again. And now you maintain pin drop silence, just mouth shut, and they speak and we hear. That is the Vedic etiquette. Okay. We don't speak to the guru. The guru speaks to us. Okay. And then we ask questions out of humility. Okay. That is it from my side. And of course, once that is done, we can talk some practical things like, you know, what is going on, you know, in the family, who is having trouble of what, or what problem is there. And then he can say, I will pray to God for you. That is perfectly fine. Then he can give you unlimited number of blessings. You know, your son is getting married, daughter is getting married, you know, what not it is. Then he can do that. That is the last thing that should happen. Okay. The first thing is enlightenment about God and the truths of the scriptures. All right. Thank you very much for your patience. And if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then you can go down to the description box here. You will find the link to my website. Okay. God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him.